Good morning, students. In the continuance of the previous lecture, whereby we discussed the two types of enactments, now we are going to further study conjunctive and disjunctive enactments. Now, if you see hereby, I've written, we've already studied in this in our previous school times that what is a conjunctive word, what is a disjunctive word, some words which connect two words, some words which connect a particular sentence are known as conjunctive words. Now, for example, conjunctive for legal prodigy, legal ideology means and. The word and used in any statute or any proviso or any provision is used in a conjunctive sense. Means it joins two sentences. Now similarly, when we are talking about disjunctive, disjunctive enactments are or provisions are those provisions whereby the use of word or is prominent. Now, what are, if we talk of in a layman language or in a normal perspective of a person, when I say, for example, I want fruits, mango and orange. I am not, if you read this sentence clearly, you are going to understand that I am telling you to give me both the things which are together. Like now if I am asking you to do, I am not giving you an option regarding any of the fruits which I am wanting to consume. Now, for example, if your mother asks you whether you want something, whether you want cornflakes for breakfast or you want cereal for your breakfast. Now, she is legitly and she is open-heartedly giving you an option between the two choices and it is your choice whether you want to have cornflakes or whether you want to have cereals or porridge and whatever. Now, similarly, conjunctive and disjunctive words are used in this sense. Now, one of the examples where or is used, for example, in IPC we must have read sentences like any person who incites or tries to incite, or for example tries to commit or try incite somebody to commit a particular crime. Now this, the particular, what I'm trying to say is, or basically generates option in front of the person who is standing in front of you, or gives you certain ideologies and gives you various options which can be considered besides the previous and besides the other factors which have been, which can be taken into place. Now, conjunctive and disjunctive interpretation of these words is an extension of a purposive theory of interpretation. Now, what is a purpose? Purpose means the main reason and logic behind the existence of something. Now, purposive theory, it means that courts are not bound. Courts should interpret a provision or a law as to why, what was the purpose behind its making, what ideology was followed, what purpose was there, what were the cases, what were the scenarios which were to be, which were followed by this court of law during the making of an enactment or an act. Now, courts are not bound by the texts which are given in the given under laws and provisions. So hereby they are not obligated and they have a lenient chance to interpret and see the foresightness of the interpretation which they are doing. Now, we've already read that why interpretation is done. Interpretation ke requirements kya hote hain? Complexity. Now, there is a disturbance in the language which is used under the statutes. Now, these are the things when you need to come to a crux of a particular thing. These are the things which need to be taken care of. The first and the foremost things is also purpose. You should try and reach to a knowledge. You and try and reach to the roots as to why this particular law had come into existence. Now, application of this rule falls under six categories. The first one is to prevent the use of arbitrary powers, whereby you know that lawyers are given arbitrary powers and similarly the judges are given arbitrary powers to interpret and mold things accordingly as they think they want. Now, for example, there is a sentence whereby you are given a provision, for example, where it is used, two words are used, which is owner or master. For example, there is a case where, you know, there is for a punishment regarding owner or a master. Now, if we try and interpret this, it gives us an option. It is legitimately dependent upon the court or probably how the circumstances be. Either the owner or the master will be liable. But under this particular, this was held on a particular case. But under this, the courts had interpreted that owner or master shall be interpreted as and. Or shall be interpreted as and. So wherever the case follows is anywhere where owners or masters are under the consideration, either the owner and the master, whatsoever, however the situation applies and wants to be, both of them will be found guilty and both of them will have the same punishments. There are no different punishments for a owner or for a master separately. Now coming to the second application is fulfillment of duties. Now this particular, it also obligates you and sets a firm stern line, you know, it draws a fine line between certain actions and for which you are either you do or not do particular actions. For example, if there are actions like, for example, if I am supposed to do for example, if I say that one person is supposed to draw and paint it as well. So you are obligated to do it as well. You have no options regarding it. Now, for example, if similar sentence is given to you in a particular manner, likewise, I say that you can either draw or paint. So I am giving you an option, it is discretionary. It is on your own discretion whether you want to draw it or you want to paint it. Now, similarly, fulfillment of duties is, it provides you with a certain relaxation and a certain obligation as to when and how you are supposed to go about performing your duties, and it also refrains you from performing certain duties. Now, third is negative and positive conditions. And or are most commonly used under English language and in the legal terms to differentiate and to segregate the positive and the negative conditions. Or means it gives you a choice. Obviously, they might end up giving you 100. For example, under one case, one instant, they might tell you four other case scenarios under which the same punishment can be held and under which same case scenarios and same law must apply. Similarly, and gives you particular, for example, and might also end up being certain situations and certain areas whereby it tells you if this act was done instead of one particular act, this can also be considered. Now, the fourth one is prevention of a crime. It gives you certain areas, it gives you a horizon of scope as to what crimes might fall under a particular scope. It gives you a horizon, it broadens your horizon. It also, while searching for crimes, while reading your law, you are given these words so that it is easier for you to have a broader perspective and a broader foresight as to what crimes might be included under a particular section and a particular crime. Now, for example, fifth application is speedy trial and justice. Obviously, they provide, since it makes it easier for a person to perceive, since you are given a lot of options and you have no bound ideology to consider, so they are, you obviously end up having a speedy trial and a speedy justice as to, because you have a clear fiction, you have a clear perspective and a clear thought as to what had happened and how to go about it. The sixth is welfare of the public. Welfare of the public is basically because not everybody has studied law. Not everybody is as literate as a lawyer or as literate as a judge sitting over there, you know, giving you judgments and giving you life sentences and everything. So basically, welfare of public, basically under what it means is that any person, for making it easy for persons to read and interpret, even if they are under, you know, understanding it at the prime, you know, on the face of it, sir, padha aur samajh liya, usse bhi agar unko kuch cheeze samajh aati hai, to ye jo words hote hain, ye hum normal sentences mein bhi use kar lete hain, to un logon ki easy ke liye. और ज्यादातर अगर हम इसको लीगल टर्मिनोलॉजीज में समझने की कोशिश करें तो उसमें ये होता है फॉर द बेटर गुड, टू कम टू अ कंक्लूजन, टू कम टू अ जस्ट सिचुएशन, टू अ जस्ट डिसीजन. सो एज whatever decision has been taken is for the greater good of the people. It is for the good and the better for the public interest and not against it. Now this was one topic for today. Coming to the second and last topic for today's lecture is internal and external aids. Now we've already studied in our second or the first lecture, there are certain parts of a statute which combine and make a very important part, which make an important part of your curriculum, and how one person can understand what exactly a statute is compiled and compacted of. Now, internal aids and external aids of an interpretation. External aids means कोई भी चीज जिससे जो out of your book which is useful for your interpretation of a particular provision. Similarly, internal aid means anything which is provided under a book which you are reading to come to a particular conclusion. Now similarly, we've already read that internal aids ke andar jo hum parts padhenge, these are basically nothing but parts of a statute. I'm going to discuss five main parts, internal aids, between you, but mind my sentence, all the parts of a statute fall under internal aids of interpretation. So the first and the foremost thing is preamble. As we've already heard, we've already read, and as many learned justices have said, that preamble forms the key to what exactly a particular statute holds. It opens the eyes of a particular person as to what you are going to read and what this particular law is supposed to convey, what a particular statute conveys a message to you. Now coming to punctuations, also preamble forms a crucial part of a act because it is considered to be one of the most important parts. It has been given under particular cases. Under Indian law we only have a preamble under the Indian Constitution, and we've read it in detail, the explanations and the amendments as to regarding whatever have happened. Now preamble basically was considered as a basic structure. It was considered as a main part of the Indian Constitution under several cases. The very first case being the Berubari case, and similarly Keshanand Bharti and so forth. Now punctuations follow up. Punctuations have always been neglected, to be honestly speaking. Punctuations follow a greater perspective towards as to how a sentence should be interpreted. Even a miscommunication or a misassumption or even a misread, removing and not reading a punctuation properly can totally change and cause blunders of a sentences. It can absolutely change the meaning of how the person standing in front of you might perceive the sentence and how you might perceive the sentence for that matter. Now title. Now we've already studied that there are two types of titles included in the in the Parcher statute. There are short title and the long title. Short title is basically the heading which is given on the cover page, is the name of the book which you are going to read. Long title being what exactly are the powers under this statute, which are basically if we are reading about income tax, so it basically gives you the powers to amend and codify laws relating to income tax, as to how person is supposed to pay taxes and how are the procedures to be followed under this particular act. Now coming to the fourth one is explanation. Explanation means any particular sentence, any particular provision which has been explained either with a hypothetical situation or with an illustration or including an exception as to what can be done, as to how, if under a certain circumstance, if there are certain hypothetical situations which might arise in the near future. So these explanations are very important and guide you towards a just and a clear judgment. Now definitions, we've already studied that most of the times under any act, definitions are provided under section 2. They provide you with general terminologies which might be used, which is definitely used in the act, and so that it is easier for the people to know what exactly it means. Now for example, you will not find every time the certain provisions which are only for female and which are both for females and for males, you will not find his or her written everywhere. Even if it is his written, it is to be considered that this particular section is also applicable to a woman also. So these are the kinds of particular applications and definitions which are given under this. For example, even the definition of a state is given, definition of a public servant, definition of a union under the IPC section 2. So these are the particular definitions. Now coming to the last topic of today is external aids. Now external aids are historical backgrounds, the original bill and its introduction. Now external aids, what do you exactly understand by external aids? I bet you must have already read about the sources of law. You know, you always have two sources of law. You have a primary source, you have a secondary source. Some sources are already available to you, and some, you know, you have to research and then you come to a conclusion, you can find them, you rewrite them, you reassess them, and then come to a particular act and a conclusion, and that is how you get your data, which is a refined data. Now similarly, coming to a external aids are nothing but already provided material which can be used by a legal person or a person who's involved into legality to come to a just and to reach to a point where he can conclude everything and refine his own data. Now coming to the first external aid is historical background. As we've already read that we already tried to understand the theory of purpose and, you know, theory of the history behind anything. So similarly, any particular case scenario or any particular law has to have a particular history, because there is always a beginning of something which has to end. So going to the crux and going to a part where it actually all started gives one person a clear perspective and gives you exactly why was the need of such kind of a law. Similarly, getting to know exactly what is the original bill, how was it introduced, why was the introduction important, how widely and vividly was it accepted by the society at that point of time, and also analyzing as to how and why and at what scale will it be accepted in today's society falls under a very good, very important external aid, which might change and cause miracles if people try and find it. Because this basically ends you, you know, this basically gives you, first and the foremost thing is, it gives you a detailed research of whatever law is being made. Second of all, it gives you a clear perspective. You've read so much about it, you've interviewed so many people about it, you've dug deep into the history that, you know, even if you're not trying to come to a conclusion, you might end up understanding certain laws and the ideologies of certain people who have been, you know, living for ages, who've been living through all the situations which have come to become action or, you know, who've come to become a law right now. Now, for example, we can take, always take an example. Now, for example, when the abolition of Sati Pratha was started, you had no particular law regarding to as to why Sati Pratha had to be abolished, because people even today in certain tribal areas still might end up following it. But people who researched about it, came to a conclusion, interviewed people, went and stayed with people to understand how they come to a conclusion where they are ready to, you know, let their daughters die when their husbands are not alive. You know, they tried in understanding the perspective, they tried to come to a, come to make amends with the fact, is this okay, is this okay, and is this okay to be continued in the coming coming years? Will this be accepted? Because obviously it was accepted, then that is the reason it was being followed. But will it be accepted by the coming society? Will it be acceptable for the people who are in the coming generation? So it gives you a very good external aid to come to a particular law, even under framing of a particular law. Obviously, it will give you a help in interpreting, because you get to know the intent and the intention behind what was it. Now, legal dictionaries. We don't have, we always have legal, by legal dictionaries, I don't mean to say that dictionaries like Oxford and LexisNexis ki dictionaries jo apan padhte hain. Legal dictionaries wo hoti hai jisme aapko case laws ka sara details diya hua hota hai. They also fall under legal dictionaries. For example, your AIR books which are kept under your libraries, and a certain, you know, there are websites also whereby we are authorized to search certain case laws to come to, you know, to refer to those case laws to understand one particular incident or a case better. Now, the third one is debates in legislature. Debates in legislature act as a good external aid, because you get to know perspective of different people. What different people might say. You know, it might also end up being, you know, some people might say in favor and some people might say not in favor. So it ends up being a cumulative decision, and it gives you a clear perspective, and also as to, you know, for example, there are 100 people sitting in a particular debate, and out of them 20 only are people who are on your side, and 80 people are against you. So you get to know where on what levels is this particular law going to be associated and being accepted by the society. So you can change and amend the laws accordingly. Now, the last one is judicial construction, which is one of the powers of the legislature, basically judicial review, which is basically the power of the courts under certain circumstances, only provided for particular case scenarios, not given to any other person. No person can do it. It is absolutely done and observant by the courts and the high courts. So this completes our one topic from module 4 and two topics from module 5. Tomorrow we are going to further complete module 5. That's for today. Thank you so much.